So my talk has essentially been summarized by Dr. Ikeda. I'll be discussing whether we should go about doing a cataract plus a pterygium surgery combined or a step. So we'll be discussing various grades of pterygium as are shown in this picture. The questions we'll answer in this presentation are, when should we perform a simultaneous or a sequential surgery? If we are supposed to perform a one-step surgery, excuse me, is it safe to perform a one-step surgery? What are the interop considerations? And how do we go about calculating the IOL power? And if we are supposed to do a simultaneous surgery, how much to wait between the two surgeries? And then we'll discuss some clinical case scenarios and we'll try to formulate some guidelines. Okay, so how to decide whether it is a one-step or two-step surgery? The most important fact here is that you have to look into the size or the girth of the pterygium per se. We'll discuss this in detail. So just remember this, size that is in clock hours and going into the cornea, and girth, that is the thickness, or whether it's a fleshy or atrophic pterygium. These two are the most important factors which have to be taken into consideration before we decide. Now, this is there are three photographs in three slides taken from a below article. I'm sorry. So this is a type 1, wherein there is a small pterygium. It is riding from periphery. If you see this central topography here, this is having a regular kind of an astigmatism on topography. That means pterygium tissue, see, this is the area of the pterygium which is obscured by in the topography. This area is that of the pterygium. See, it's coming from this side. So it is coming onto the cornea, it is affecting the topography, but it is still not affecting the central 3 to 4 millimeters of the optical zone. So you can still go ahead with a one-step surgery. This is to crudely say that. Another photograph of the same article, see the amount of pterygium it has. It's a highly fleshy pterygium, multiple vessels, appears to be thick. See the effect it's showing on the topography. It's affecting the topography till here. It's almost encroaching the central 3 to 4 millimeters. And if you see the astigmatism, it's highly irregular. So herein we would be, you know, inclined to do a two-step surgery rather than a one-step surgery. We'll discuss in detail further. Again, atrophic kind of a pterygium, by the TANS classification, you would feel it's an atrophic pterygium. But see the how much amount of astigmatism it is causing in the center. So you would definitely be inclined to do a two-step surgery in this. So this is in a nutshell, but we'll discuss this in detail. So one study which has been published, which it tells us that if the size of the pterygium is 2 millimeters or more into the cornea, you are more inclined to go towards a two-step surgery because it is more likely to cause a residual astigmatism. So the advantage of one-step surgery, obviously it's a single-step surgery, so it's economic, it's good for the patient, good for the doctor, and it's more relevant in the Indian setting because we have a lot of patients coming to us with cataract and pterygiums. The next question was whether it is safe to combine an intraocular and an extraocular procedure. So multiple studies have shown that it is safe to do an intraocular and an extraocular procedure combined. Study published in Journal of Postgraduate Medicine showed it's safe. Another study showed that there was no evidence of any infections if we do a TRAB or a cataract along with the pterygium. This was published in BJO. Another study recently showed that a combined procedure did not result in any complications. So doing a combined surgery, whether it is when it is allowed, is safe. That is what we have proven now. Next is, suppose we are doing a combined surgery, how do you predict the IOL power? Because whenever you remove the pterygium, obviously the K1, K2 will change, the IOL power will change. So this study showed us that at 3 months, if the pterygium was small enough, 48% of the eyes were within plus or minus 0.5 diopters of effect, emetropia or the whatever the result, refraction was aimed for, and around 82% were within 1 diopter. It's intuitive. Larger the pterygium pre-op, larger the change in K, and larger the instability of the error. The larger amount of pterygium which was the pre-op, if you do it a simultaneous surgery, obviously the errors would tend to be higher. So this is very intuitive, but that is what was shown by this article. Another article told us that if you make a calculation by a DC by A formula, where D is the arc length, the extent into the cornea, B is the arc length, A is the this distance, then you can try to find out that, you know, how much you will be able to achieve near your aimed refraction. And what they told was that only the extension of the pterygium was important. The width and the area ratio was not important. Extension into the cornea, I mean. Japanese have found out, they have put some multiple complications and multiple permutations and combinations. They have found out a formula that if you put this kind of formula, you would be able to achieve within plus or minus 0.5 diopters. I don't use it, but it was there in the literature, so I'm projecting it. Appears to be very complex. So Another study which we had, another study was large, showed us that the, if the size of the pterygia is more than 2.4, that is, jaisa maine pehle bola, 2 centimeters or 2 millimeters or more, then the implied AIOC should be at least 0.5 diopters less than what you are aiming for. Again, intuitively, it means the same, because the K1, K2 will change, that's why your power has to reduce down. So, finishing off with one step, the IOL considerations are, you should avoid toric IOLs or any astigmatic corrections in this procedure, because you don't know how much key reading will change on itself. So try to put in monofocal IOLs and always prepare the patient that you might end up having some kind of a residual astigmatism. So surgical considerations are, because you're combining an intraocular and an extraocular procedure, ensure that the tunnel is watertight. There is low threshold for suturing. Because you want to ensure that it's tight, there should be a low threshold for suturing. Side ports should be carefully placed. So now pterygiums are either medial or temporal. I'm a temporal surgeon, so if I'm sitting temporal and I make side, and the pterygium is nasal, or if somebody is sitting superior and the pterygium is nasal, then side ports could give you a problem. So side ports position should be carefully placed. Bandage continence may be considered because it helps in faster healing. Lubrication has to be more than adequate than what is required for a cataract surgery. Low frequency of steroids, at least in the initial part, till the pterygium surface heals, the corneal surface heals. So next is, when do we do a two-step surgery? So as has been told by me in the previous slides, the general rule of consensus is 2 millimeters or more pterygia in the cornea, try to go for a two-step surgery. But there are caveats, and we'll show this in the clinical examples. So one study showed that if there was, the next question is, how much to wait? Suppose you have done a pterygium surgery now, how much should you wait before doing a cataract surgery? So there are multiple studies showing that one study says it should be 1 month. Another study says it is as good as 1 week. Another study says, so there are variations, okay? So normally I would tend to wait for about 2 to 4 weeks for the epithelialization to take place, ocular surface to stabilize, conjunctiva to become normal. So all these things would lead for me to, you know, for me to wait around 2 to 4 weeks. But that can be customized if the patient is outstationed. So obviously you plan the pterygium surgery first and wait for about 2 to 4 weeks. Lubrication is very, very important. So this was a study published recently, and it showed us that in sequential surgery patients, the K reading tends to stabilize at 1 month, and it stayed so. Post cataract surgery, there was no change. This is pre-op astigmatism around 7. This is post-op immediate, that is 1.88. This is post-op 1 month, around 1.49. So there's only a change of around 0.3 to 0.4 at a month, which is not very important. So probably you can take up surgery relatively early. This is the same thing. So what they showed was, after sequential pterygium cataract surgery, the astigmatism could be controlled. Obviously, it is intuitive. You don't need to, you know, remember that. So the most important factor is size and girth, and we have to measure the astigmatism based upon if you have it topography. So we'll take some 5 examples, and that will make the picture clear. So we have a case here of a cataract with a pterygium. Pterygium is starting here, and this is the area of the pterygium. So what should be the plan? We have a show of hands here. One step, two step.
Yeah.
One step. How many for two step? Okay.
Can I have a different option?
Yes, sir. Please.
I will ask the patient whether he is really bothered by this. If he's not bothered and he's cosmetically not concerned, so it's your problem that you are trying to address. If the patient says, this, I'm not bothered, I'll just do a cataract surgery.
Absolutely correct.
And also we need to look at the astigmatism. So can correct. We have the topography,
yes.
Or tell us the amount,
yes,
of,
yes,
astigmatism,
yes,
that this patient has?
We'll be coming
has.
In that. So the size measured was 2.8. I am telling the size because we have earlier read that 2.4 or more, we should be going for a two-step surgery. That's what I'm just telling you. I'll show you the topography now. So astigmatism was around 3.5 diopters, and there was an indentation. Now, I don't know if you can see this. See, there's a line here, as if something is pressing onto the cornea. This indentation is very classical. So this indentation tells you that it is causing some kind of astigmatism on the cornea. See, this is the topography picture. See how much about of pressure this cornea is causing. If you make a white line, see this. Okay, and the astigmatism is, the astigmatism is around 5.6 diopters. See this, 5.6 diopters. So the topographic astigmatism is 5.6 diopters, the acceptance is 3.5 diopters. So now what you should be doing, one step or two step? Two step. So this is a, if you can just do a simple K1, K2, you will come to know. We'll discuss this again in the examples ahead. So the plan would be to do a two-step surgery. Okay. Next example, very small pterygium. See that? It's nothing. What would you do? One step, two step. So millimeters would be around, probably not less than two here. Yeah, I'll come to the astigmatism. Before that, one step, two step. See the astigmatism, 7.28. So that's what I was trying to tell you. The study says 2 millimeter or more, but even smaller pterygiums can cause high astigmatism. So K1, K2 is essential. Size is not very important actually. So this small kind of a fleshy pterygium, because it was a thick pterygium, it was pressing on the cornea and causing a high astigmatism. So it was causing a 7.2 diopter of astigmatism. See the picture there, top right. This is the indentation caused by the pterygium here. So it is causing a high astigmatism. Now one step, two step, fast. Yeah. So this is the same picture showing a 7 diopter of astigmatism.
Came for pterygium surgery.
This patient came for cataract surgery. Okay. So I was planning a cataract surgery. I did a K1, K2. I found it was. I also didn't realize it would be a 7 diopter astigmatism.
The superior limbus looks a little abnormal to me. Did he have?
That was this degeneration.
That case, the K-max is 53.
Yeah. Just the pterygium.
So that could be artifactual, no? Because it is compressive. Probably. So this other, see this patient, again came for a cataract surgery. Both eyes pterygium, vision is there, K1, K2 is there. 4 diopter of astigmatism on the right side and about 8 diopter of astigmatism on the left side. This was also a scarring. This patient has already had a pterygium surgery, has a lot of scarring on the cornea and also has some kind of recurrence. Okay, I'm just finishing. 2 more cases. Again, very small pterygium. This is the last patient, last case of mine. Again a small pterygium, but with a good astigmatism, only of about 0.4 or 0.5. So in this case, it would be ideal to go for a one step. So then, in a nutshell, what I'm trying to explain here is pterygium girth and size is definitely important, but please do K1, K2. K1, K2 is as simple a test which you can do in your clinic, which will guide you whether you should be doing a grade surgery or a simultaneous surgery. Otherwise, patient would not be happy. If you do a simultaneous surgery, then the ileal power calculation will go haywire. And then it will be a problem for you. So my take home points would be, obviously the size and girth is important. Do a keratometry and a topography. Simultaneous one step would be when the cylinder is less than 2 diopters. A central case should be a symmetric or a regular, that is if you have a topography. And it is safe to do a simultaneous surgery. And if you are supposed to do a sequential surgery, cylinder case should ideally be more than 2. If it is showing any case of irregular astigmatism, 2 side surgery is definitely warranted. And 2 to 4 weeks of interval is ideal between 2 surgeries. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rajat, for extensively reviewing the literature and keeping us interested with your wonderful examples.
Yes.
So, does anybody in the audience would like to ask any questions?
Yes, please.
Please come near my those who you want to ask questions.
Two-step surgery only reason is the after surgery the refractive outcome only, na?
Correct. Yes.
Or any other thing.
Sir, IOL power calculation जब हम करते हैं ना one step में तो उसमें अगर astigmatism बहुत ज़्यादा है तो हमारा IOL power calculation अच्छा नहीं होगा.
But sometimes it happens, the hypermature cataract is there and pterygium more than 3-4 millimeter.
For that, I suggest a slightly different approach. The patient who have hypermature cataract, pterygium, that means the pterygium has been there for 20-30 years. Cataract has come later, and they are not very keen on surgery. So whatever surgery you do, if you do, think of doing the surgery which will enhance the vision, rather than trying to address the astigmatism part. So therefore, in those patients, I'll do the cataract surgery first, and say if you are not happy or if the vision is not suboptimal, then think of correcting that later.
Okay.
So that's a very personalized approach.
Sir, वैसे भी जो patient आपके पास total hemipelagic cataract के साथ आया है, उसको वैसे भी आधे number एक number से फर्क पड़ने वाला नहीं है। उसमें तो cataract करना better ही है।
I want to add that thing.
उसमें तो cataract नहीं करना। We are talking about refractive results. So if you want to have a good refractive result, do a two-step surgery. But obviously, if you are sitting in a periphery, गांव की अम्मा वगैरह आती हैं उनको, तो फिर तो हमें cataract करना
है। I'm working in a periphery.
Yes, definitely cataract surgery should be done.
More than 80% cases I'm doing.
Yeah, definitely you should do a cataract surgery.
In those patients. patient, please do cataract.
Yes.
Because if you do pterygium, they will start believing these surgeries don't help.
Yes.
The doctors do surgery only for themselves.
Yes.
So make sure that you address what the patient wants.
वो दूसरी surgery के लिए आएंगे भी नहीं आपके
पास. Yeah, exactly.
Correct. Sir.
Some of the cases, whatever you showed, the level of astigmatism may not be just pterygium induced.
Correct.
As all of us know.
So we have compared
it might just a T1 or T2 level of pterygium, where it is not just a pterygium induced also.
Yeah.
Of course, doing two-step surgeries is fine to be on a safer side, but post pterygium surgery, you'll know the exact level of astigmatism left out.
Yes.
So how much is pterygium induced is always a question. So depending on that, always you can decide. Probably can do a trial and find out what was exactly pterygium induced. So that way, one step or two step depends on the level of astigmatism also fine, but how much is pterygium induced is a question, because it might be a pre-existing corneal astigmatism or any other reason related also. Many a times central optic zone may not be involved also with all the pressures and astigmatism and other things. So even after refractive surgeries also, we do have a lot of corneal astigmatism, but patient will be having 6-6 vision sometimes,
yes.
You know, post-LASIK and other things. Similarly, here also we might have 6-6 vision without any additional spectacle aids and other things. So it's always a question whether we were really sure enough to do such procedures regularly or not.
Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you.
No, I think it's very valid points that what you made, and it has to be looked into the context of that particular patient. And in your view, what you are seeing astigmatism, is it likely to be caused by pterygium?
Yeah.
It's very important to segregate these two, induced by pterygium versus innate astigmatism in that cornea.
So that can be known only once we operate the pterygium and then find the post-op case.
So preoperatively, I think it's also important to tell the patients, because there is obviously a residual corneal scarring. If the pterygium has been there for years and years, you might address the pterygium, but the scarring itself can lead to an astigmatism.
Yeah.
So that again becomes really, really important in these cases. Yes,
I think the question of addressing the pterygium and this as a one stage or two stage would also derive from the fact whether this is a progressive pterygium or not. If it's a pterygium that's been sitting there for 10 years, creating a diopter and a half of astigmatism, but is completely stable, quiet, atrophic, I wouldn't touch it at all.
Yeah.
I would just leave it, because I'd expect that pterygium to remain stable the way it is and deal with the astigmatism in the cataract surgery. Rather than to do the question of doing the pterygium doesn't come up at all. So I think that's also one aspect that has to be looked at when one is assessing these patients.
Yeah, this is the same thing which I said earlier. The patient who are waiting and not getting pterygium surgery for 20, 30 years, that means they are not really cosmetically bothered by that. And also their vision probably whatever before cataract, they were happy. So therefore, it's very important to take feedback from your patient. What is that they are looking for? And then how accurate their IOL power calculation. And demanding patient, yes, you may do all these things what he was telling. Otherwise, if you're a rural setting, your requirement might be totally different.
So again, if this patient to me, to my mind, if the patient was supposed, again depends on, like sir rightly said, on how the patient, what the patient expects post-operatively. If he came and told me that I really don't want to wear glasses post-operatively and he had 1.5 diopter of an astigmatism, then I would still think of doing a two-step surgery if I'm thinking of implanting a toric IOL. That to my mind, if the pterygium has been there for 10 years, would be the only indication if the patient is very, very particular that after cataract surgery is very demanding and he really doesn't want to wear glasses, then I would tell him, yes, let's do pterygium surgery first. Let's see how much of astigmatism we can get rid of, whether we can bring it down to less than one diopter by a simple pterygium surgery, and whether you really need a toric IOL or not. To me, that would be the only indication. Otherwise, I would rightly said, go ahead with just a simple cataract surgery. And also, I would like to make a comment about the superior and the temporal where you're sitting. So what I typically do is when I combine cataract and pterygium in one sitting, I go according to my comfort zone. I shift position. So I do my cataract temporally, and then I shift and do a pterygium superiorly. So that again becomes an option, and so that we are comfortable. Whatever we've been doing, we don't disturb that and try not to do one surgery from the other side. Makes life a little bit easier.
The benefit of that also is that your side port is away from the pterygium site. So you know, if you're sitting temporal, your side port is 10-2, and then you do a nasal pterygium, that's totally away from the, so there's no communication of outside and inside.
That also helps.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
No, you should have a stability of K1, K2, obviously.
So, very simply to conclude, I would say that if you don't have topography, don't have anything, just do a simple acceptance. Check how much cylinder the patient is actually accepting. Do a simple keratometry, do a refraction and a keratometry, and then decide whether it's really thick and fleshy, keeping the patient's expectations in mind and whether really patient wants pterygium removal or not, and what is his requirement post-op after cataract surgery. Is he a very demanding patient? Does he require freedom from glasses? That would be the top points to decide whether we need to do a one-step or a two-step procedure. Yes.
I have a question for Dr. Rishi Mohan. At times, we see that after the graft, we have done the surgery. So there's a sanguineous collection of fluid below the graft. Are there any tips or tricks to prevent that, and does it ultimately affect the outcome? I mean, any comment on that?
That's a good question, and we do see that. We see that largely in, if the grafts are large, we see it in grafts which have a lot of subconjunctival tissue, that means thick grafts. You also see retraction as well as it crumples up and gets raised because of the serosanguinized fluid. It can happen if there was not enough hemostasis that had been produced. So one way is to just puncture it, or on table, many people create multiple perforations in the graft to allow a serosanguinous ooze to come out. I personally don't find it to be very useful. I do leave a few nicks in this graft when I'm using a large graft. So if I have something which is like 8 millimeters by 9 millimeters or 10 millimeters, in that kind of a conjunctival autograft, I will make a couple of central perforations so that I don't impact the edge, to maybe allow whatever fluid accumulates to come up. Otherwise, the other thing that you will see happening is if you are not using adequate steroid, then again you're going to get more of this kind of occurrence. So those are just the tips that I can share. I'm not sure if there's anything more. So that, pretty much.
I think it's primarily the function of how much is the bleeding under the graft and how tightly you make it adherent. Sometimes you see the same situation in under the amniotic membrane. So what you could do is, if you are anticipating, you can make some holes in the on the graft, but it's likely to close very quickly. In amniotic membrane, it won't close, but in the conjunctival autograft, it's